The views and opinions on this podcast do not necessarily reflect those of the executive producer or the sponsors. They are those of the hosts and guests only. We believe freedom of conscience means the right to speak free, to think and believe as you will without the imposition of official coercive power over those beliefs. Liberty cannot exist when people are forced to conform their thoughts and expression to an official viewpoint. Differences of opinion are the natural byproducts of a vibrant, free society. Thank you. Live from Studio Diablo in Chicago, Illinois, this is MK Ultrasound.
Get with the countdown.
I speak jive.
Forget it, man. Blast off for Kingsville. Shake this square world. Blast off for Kingsville.
I speak jive.
Forget it, man. Get with the countdown.
I speak jive.
Forget it, man. Blast off for Kingsville. Shake this square world.
In 1 week on the MK Ultrasound Podcast, December 11, 2022, 1 year in the making, Alexander and Detroit Kensky bringing their favorite songs from their favorite Detroit, Michigan bands, the home of Cream Magazine, and FYI, it's not safe for work.
And neither is this show. I want to thank our guests, third time on, Dave.
You did the
stingers for us.
You can hear when I say podcast, you can hear I'm actually a Chicagoan podcast.
You know, it's a funny conversation. My friend Adam and I discuss Chicago PD and Chicago Fire. And first of all, no cop, no fireman makes enough money to live the way these guys live in their houses.
Where do they live? Well, don't they for real live down in Bridgeport?
No, right? A lot of them in the West Loop.
Oh,
but
okay.
The funny thing, and the other thing is, and Adam also said nobody has a Chicago accent, and I'm like, except for the one guy, you know, the guy that co-owner of the bar, and it's just when you brought that up, that's seriously, you do hear the Chicago in you. Max Bravo is with us filling in for a missing in action co-guest. So Max, thank you at the last minute.
Anytime.
I reached out to you. You were having a little bit of fun last night?
A little bit.
I'm not even going to embarrass you by reading you the text, because you do the same thing to me.
Exactly.
When I'm having too much fun, Max, in public, you don't even open my messages.
Yeah, I don't. I'm occupied otherwise.
Dave, thanks. You brought some gifts. Thank you.
Yeah,
you brought
man.
Some new music and new videos. You have a new record out.
Yeah, that's right. Mercenary Notes Part 1, Derision Cult, we released Friday, so Bandcamp Friday. And yeah, it went really well.
Stellar lineup.
Yeah, man. Sean Payne from Cyanotic produced it, and he's kind of become my partner in crime on that. But then Chris Connelly from, of course, Pigface Ministries on there. Reeves, Gabrels from The Cure played some lead guitar on that. And then Justin Broderick from Godflesh is on there as well. So, that worked out pretty good. We got a little tribe going now.
Good. Well, that's Chicago needs that again.
Yeah,
we haven't had that in a while.
So. Well, you know, it's cool. I know you had the Joy Thieves on here.
Oh, my God.
What was that last week? And They did a remix for the track Deaf Blood that turned out awesome. So we're turning into like collectives now.
Their names are on everything though. The Joy Thieves mix of this and
yeah,
that.
Yeah.
Armalite Records is a good place to call home for a lot of these bands that don't have a home anymore, because we really don't have Wax Tracks or Invisible. Or we don't.
Yeah, yeah. We have our own we have Glitch Mode, which is like what Cyanotic Farmco and all that. And now this Mercenary Notes is on.
I know Sean from well, you know, we were all friends with Jamie Duffy.
Yeah.
And it's still like I walk into the House of Blues or Cubby Bear and I expect to see him.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's funny is when because we made a lot of this at Sean's studio, and he's got a picture of Jamie Duffy above the mixing console, and then his amp actually re-recorded a lot of this stuff with. And Sean's always kind of the mantra is like once you know, we get it to where Jamie Duffy's head's bobbing, that's the sign. All right, this is the right mix.
And that kid was good, man.
Yeah, yeah.
Just he was just really, really, really good. And he was a good person, and I still miss him. Okay, well, let's just jump right into it. You gave us videos for every song. Thank you for that.
Yeah, man.
And this is all fresh shit. And you sent us a song that we played with the last week on the Thanksgiving show. So thanks for that. And so we're going to start off with Bastards of the World. And what's the backstory on this one?
Just sell you another fucking Nissan. That's what it says in the that's what it says in the track. But no, this I know the last one I talked I drew a lot on just my the experience I had in the ad industry, and that's kind of what this one was. I was approached by a gun manufacturer to help them market an AR-15 for kids. And it actually was a training rifle, like so grandpa could teach the kid how to shoot, but they didn't give a shit about that. What they wanted me to do was go push ads and push this message like the Rachel Maddows and people like that, so they'd lose their shit about these idiots making this gun, because they had the data that showed they sold more ammo and more weapons whenever those people got pissed.
That's interesting.
And that was so, and they'd done, and they're like, you know, you. One of the things I'm kind of known for is doing these, like, I can market straight to Alex, and Alex gets swarmed with these ads. So I go make all those writers at the Daily Show and all that see this messaging, and they're going to get mad and write about it. Yeah, and we're going to sell a ton of guns and ammo. And I didn't take the project, but it was a pretty big inspiration. There's some samples in here from a colleague of mine where it talks about, you know, wearing things like, you know, kind of materialistic, this message that, you know, if I have nice possessions, your children are more likely to survive you mate with me than someone wearing a Swatch watch and driving a Mercury Tracer. And so anyways, I'm like, yeah, we're kind of the bastards of the world here.
All right. And this is on the MK Ultrasound podcast and on the Outlaw Television Network.
Yeah.
Germans.
I didn't realize how long that fade out goes, man. That's like a robot eating itself at the end.
Someone's been listening to KMFDM. Did you get, Gunther from the band to play on that?
No. I just saw him, though, at the Metro a couple weeks ago, KMFDM. Shit, about a month ago now.
They're good at consistently putting out product. Like, Sasha's pretty much almost every year.
I Ain't is a cool album, man.
I haven't heard it.
They're bringing back some more of the dub and reggae stuff in that.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah.
I also like Slick Idiot.
Yeah, God, I haven't listened to that.
That was fun stuff. We're going to have some funny stories after the next song because we just had a discussion that I didn't know about. And perfect for this show. It ties in with a couple of joy thieves. And
yeah,
I'm telling you one thing, man. Cassie, you did a bang up job editing that fucking mess of a show. But it was so much fun. I mean, I need to explain. I wish Cassie had a microphone here so she could tell you. But Matt set up the cameras because Cassie couldn't
Matt
come here.
Matt from Joy Thieves?
Yeah, Matt Clark and Mary's Window. And he put my camera in his camera. And in one camera, you got the back of the other camera. So Cassie had to do this fancy editing. And, you know,
it looks raw.
I just don't usually watch the shows after I do it. I mean, the one show I listen to over and over again is the show I did with I Love Rich because it was, you know, you got a bunch of friends together. It's just really a good, fun show.
But, yeah.
And Joy Thieves, that show, they brought Amy in. And it was the first time I'd met her.
I was watching that, yeah.
And I'd laughed. Amy was talking about how funny it was. And I'm just fucking, I had more fun watching it than I had doing it. And if you watch the show, you could tell we were all having fun. And man, Cassie talked about how, you know, we got off topic a little bit. But I'm like, that's kind of what we do. It's not all about music. But God, man, what a fun show to watch. And
I was watching a clip. She was talking about the rules about when you get into that band, like you can't fuck the singer or something like that.
She's married, but one thing I do love about Amy, like me, she hates Motley Crue. So on January 15th, we're gonna do a show all about how much we hate Motley Crue, and so maybe Max will have you on there if you're in town. Okay. And
John Five's in playing with them now.
What a waste of talent.
I kind of thought that too.
I mean, it must be a hell of a paycheck, but I mean, Zombie makes good money and tours consistently, so it must be a hell of a paycheck because he's way better than anything that Motley Crue could do.
And it's not like, well, Rob still makes new stuff.
Yeah, crank. So, good stuff. I buy them.
I think our days of seeing new Motley Crue albums are done.
Oh, God, I hope
maybe,
not.
Maybe not. I don't know.
If they do one, then that'd give you something to make fun of. So we're going to jump into the next song because I want to talk about what we were talking about just a few moments ago during that last song. But Deaf Blood, this features Chris Connelly, Reeves Gabe. How do you say his
Reeves Gabrels, yeah. He does a killer guitar solo in it.
And it's just crazy, man, that you – I love the whole industrial scene where everybody jumps in each other's projects. And that's one thing that brought me to Chicago was that.
Well, the thing was when we started demoing this, I just heard in my head, like, we need some angry Scottish guy yelling, you know. And, well, I know one. So I reached out to Dan, actually, from Joy because he, you know, the Joy Thieves connection. Hey, you think Chris would do this? And I – you know, he talked to him and Chris was into it. And then it was one of those deals where I sent Chris that track on like a Thursday. And he's like, I'll have it to you by Saturday. Saturday morning at 7 a.m., all the stems. He must have tracked the thing at like 5 in the morning. And and it was, I mean, you hear it. I mean, it wasn't like he just like sang into a can and called it good. I mean, there's massive harmonies on it and everything. But then, so Chris, now we're like, okay, we're cooking with gasoline here. And so we made a bucket list of like who else would be cool to be on this. And Reeves Gabrels is a guitar hero of mine. For like Tin Machine's how I kind of stopped thinking the world started and stopped with like Dave Mustaine and, you know, changed everything I thought about guitar. And then what he did with Bowie and Nails. And he played on a Sister Machine Gun album called Metropolis in 97.
I like that record a lot.
Right. And so me too. And I thought, man, I wonder if he'd be up for, because now he plays in The Cure, he'd be up for making a bunch of loud noise again. Like, and it just so happened with Omicron, The Cure, because Cure's got a new album coming out.
Okay.
And they're on tour. Well, they he couldn't fly over to do any of the mixing or overdubs for it in the UK because they weren't letting people travel. And so I emailed him, and because I did know him a little bit from like around that time. And sure enough, he, I got some downtime. I'll lay some guitar down for it. And he plays on a few of the tracks on the album. And
again, tell everybody where they can get the album. What's
it called? It's called Mercenary Notes Part 1. You can buy it at derisioncult.com. Takes you to Bandcamp and everything. We're slowly trickling those out to Spotify and all that. But that worked out awesome having Reeves on there. And it's total, I mean, you'll hear it. It's a total old school throwback to Tin Machine. And,
oh, wow.
It's noisy guitar. So he said it was a nice break between doing Cure. You know, this is a great, palate cleanser from doing all the Cure stuff.
Who was the other guy in Tin Machine other than David
Bowie? Well, it was David Bowie, then it was the Sals Brothers. So it was Iggy Pop's drummer and bass player.
Wow.
And, I thought that out. Those two albums are sweet, but I know they're kind of the redhead stepchild of the David Bowie legacy. But when that was kind of how I got into Bowie. And I'm probably the one guy who can say that I got into Bowie through Tin Machine. But this track sounds like a Tin Machine song too. I think Tin Machine meets like Killing Joke or something.
All right, let's hear it here on the MK Ultrasound Podcast.
I mean, most of us, if you're like me, at least I'm kind of addicted to it, but I try to keep it. Never.
that's definitely Angus Scott.
No, he delivered, man. He said it too. He's like, I think I can do this justice.
Yeah, that's fantastic. And yeah, I remember selling CDs to Chris Connelly at Reckless.
Oh yeah, well then he managed it, didn't he?
Yeah, but it was weird going there and like somebody that I love his work, his body of work, and you know, I'm a huge Revolting Cox fan. And my favorite, what was your favorite Revco record?
Probably, what was the one right after Beer Steers and Queers? Linger Frickin' Good.
That's my favorite.
And the Helicopter and...
Oh, God. And the samples they got on there of Tim Leary. That might have been the last thing.
Turn that down.
And I love the song, the one, Who's Your Favorite Cock? And they talk about Chris Connelly. It's Dwayne Buford calling out everybody in a band. And that was a lot of fun. That was a fun band then. And that's when Al was a very, very hot mess. But I think
he
did a lot of good work, though.
Chris talked about that in his book, how he was Al wasn't all that involved in that one.
But they were supposed to do one side, the one guys, and the other side. As Al called it, the book club, and then there's you know, the other side.
I asked Martin about that, the book club thing. Well, I mean, yeah.
So you were telling me something I didn't know. That you're from a small town in Iowa, which also Dan Milligan came from. And
that's right.
And Anya from Ayatollia.
Well, she was, lived there.
She's Polish.
Yeah. It's a funny accent in Iowa. But
in the same town as who else came from?
Oh, John Wayne Gacy.
I've got the Gacy, a chunk of the wall of the prison he was in Anamosa, Iowa. I went up there a couple times. I took the tour. It was interesting that it was built by the prisoners. But you all, and I had mentioned... Well, Slipknot came from there. I mean, you never imagined the biggest metal band in the world came from there.
And if you live there.
You said that his mother.
No, we used to, well, Corey, the singer, is originally from a town called Evansdale. And I think his mom still lives there. And we used to buy pot from his mom. She was about 8, 19, 20. And she's who sold the weed around there.
Out of a trailer. That's, I just love
that. Yeah, the Deerfield Park. I think that was where she, anyways. Yeah, and then, but, you know, it's funny because that came out of nowhere, it felt like. Like, I knew who Slipknot was, and I knew that they were making, you know, stuff in Des Moines, but all those guys are from other bands, you know, and so we played with, I was in a band that played with this band called Dead Front that Jim was in, and, yeah, suddenly they got that Ozfest, you know, slot.
Well, that's when I met them. I met them at Ozfest the day the record dropped. And they already knew the numbers were going to be massive. And I interviewed the guys. And I knew Sean, the clown.
He used to run a club called the Safari in Des Moines.
And he had already had a slew of kids. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, I'm looking at this band and how many members. I'm like, how do you pay? How do you guys get paid?
It doesn't cost a lot to live in Des Moines.
No, but just to live on the road overhead. And support, because you know the buses, you got to pay the label back for those things.
Well, I think Sean, he might have had some family money or something. I might be talking out of turn, but I know he used to own a bar before Slipknot took off, and it was called the Safari, and he's who booked all the bands. So I remember talking to Sean, you know,
"You think we can get on the bill Thursday?" You know? I just couldn't believe how huge those guys got.
Yeah. Like fucking huge. Well, what was funny is, it blew up huge. And it wasn't really till like that third record I really dug them, the one that Rick Rubin produced.
Okay.
Because that's the one where they started really getting psychedelic and everything. So I really dug that one. And now I like Iowa and the first one a lot, but... just where I was musically at the time. But then they made, Corey and Jim made that Stone Sour record. I'll tell you another story. They made that in Cedar Falls, Iowa. And that's where I lived at the time. And there used to be a strip joint called Flirts that we'd all hang out at after. And Corey got banned for life from there
because
he punched a hole in the wall. And I don't remember why. I just remember. And this is back when they had masks and no one knew what they looked like. You know,
okay.
And so none of the bouncers knew who that was or anything.
See, if they would have known, they would have just put a sign there that said, "Corey punched this hole in the wall." Yeah. And people will get their pictures with it.
I remember when it happened, they wouldn't let, you know, and, but, He probably doesn't like those stories being told now because now he's Mr. Sober Guy, but it was...
He's very serious.
It was a little different back then.
Max, you're quiet.
You're doing some good conversation here that I couldn't build his stories.
I want to jump into something. I haven't seen you in a while, by the way. It's good to see you again. You've been on the road or in the air a lot this year.
Yeah.
Really?
And
family trips.
We've seen a couple good movies together, and this year was no disappointment with X and then Pearl. And I'm really excited for the next one. Yeah, it's fucking funny. But so, you know, we're film buffs, but we're in the music box. And it wasn't like the new 400 where we went and got a senior citizen discount.
Right.
These people were like, not funny. So Max and I are like, not just inside, with the fucking, the pig with the maggots on it. There's an inside joke there. And
but it was the colors, the way it would play from one scene to the next.
And we were
it
just
would
like
be a red, and a red would appear. The next scene, it would lead to something
technicolor.
Else. Yeah.
But the thing and the beauty of that was we were just fascinated with how good the film was, and we kept commenting and shh, shh, smart to be fuck you, man.
Well, he was, and then finally we had our laugh over the maggot pig, and that's when he really turned back and.
I got a maggot pig story to say, share in a minute, but
I got a maggot pig story.
I do. It's a good
doesn't
one.
Everybody.
that's good first date.
No,
that's
it's a good first. No, date it's material. Not a woman. I thought you were saying I dated a. All right, I'm going to get to the point here. I find it funny that the girl that played Wednesday Addams in the Wednesday series, which is just phenomenal.
Everyone says that. I haven't seen
so
it
good. It's so mm-hmm. fun, and it really gets fun when Fester shows up, and. The thing is a scene stealer.
Yeah. Really?
It's done. Well, it's Tim Burton had his, you know, back when he was, everything was a hit with him. And it's like that style. And it's a style that fits him perfectly. But that girl was Church Mouse in the movie X.
Correct.
And she was the sound girl for the porn company.
Until she decided, hey, I'm getting in.
I want to be in the movie. I don't want to get fucked too. And my brother, he has a thing for women like her. And he's like, I thought Church Mouse was the hottest. And I'm like, I figured you would.
But, I can't even think of what she looks like.
So when we were seeing Pearl at the Music Box, which was a fun, that night ended up being a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. And I had to work the next day, and I usually don't do that. But we were on a roll having fun. And but my pig, so that pig was covered in maggots. And remember when the girl, the sister-in-law came up and says, is that right. our pig? And back in the night, in the 80s when my father was up for re-election in Ohio, he had a fundraiser, which he would call fundraisers, and they had a pig roast. And I was there with my friend, Mike Hostetler, who we nicknamed Stenchface. And funny, he called me last night. And we were like, hey, can we have the head off the pig? And they gave us the head off the pig. I just cut it off the pig, and we put it in the car. And we went Martin's Ferry, where I lived at the time, and we're driving around, and Mike's got his head out the window with that pig, and he's just eating the meat off of it, grossing people out. So, and we had it in a box, so we're not bringing that thing up the stairs to my apartment. So we just left it out in the porch, and it's summertime. So it's like July, August, and I go down the stairs. This thing was rancid, stunk.
Oh, yeah.
And it's covered in maggots, just like that freaking pig was. And I was thinking, should I go take a bite out of that pig?
Probably not.
All right, hang on 1 second, guys.
Every great day starts with a cup of Get the Fuck Out of Bed coffee from Martin Atkins and Dark Matter Coffee. Go to darkmattercoffee.com. Look for the big red logo that says Get the Fuck Out of Bed. America runs on damage, and it all starts with a cup of Get the Fuck Out of Bed coffee. There are 10 commandments and there are 7 deadly sins, but there is only one MKUltra magazine. Visit us daily online at www.mkultramagazine.com for entertainment news, reviews, and interviews. MKUltramagazine.com, home of Alexander's Diary of a Damn Man. That's MKUltramagazine.com.
And by the way, thanks to Josh Dick from Dick Liquor's Liquor Company, or one of our new sponsors. And, thanks to him, we're getting the site put back together. Slow process because the hosts couldn't handle the material. So I've got like 20 years of my work.
Oh,
it's gone, hacked, fucking. And we've got to go through thousands, like 390,000 files to go through to pull this shit out. It's, and I think about it really pisses me off because that's my life. That's, yeah, you know, I've had that, that site since 99. And Diary was a big part of it. I've got to put all these great stories back in. And Max is a lot of those. You're in a lot of those stories.
Yes.
It's, as is Cassie. Mm-hmm. And it just sucks because, you know, think about the anniversaries of these things. Like, I had pictures of when Cassie and I first met. That just at a porn convention. Now, two people into music, which is our lives, meet at a porn convention. How random is that? Mm-hmm. And then, Max, you've been to a few of those shows with me.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, a couple.
Any highlights?
Yeah. Your Ron Jeremy interview.
Oh, yeah.
Dude, have you seen him lately?
Those pictures are horrible. He looks like Cousin It. No. Cousin It.
Yeah.
It's sad.
I mean, he's got to be mid-70s, right?
Yeah, he looks... You know, the thing about it, he was always a fun guy, but you were saying, because I think we talked about this after the Tammy Faye Baker movie. And Ron Jeremy, ironically, when he did that Surreal World show with Eric Estrada and Minnie Me and
Yeah, he became good friends with her.
Yeah, they were tight. And you would think that the preacher's wife, right,
yeah,
would just be turned off. And I think when they cast him, they wanted to be that. And they ended up becoming very, very good friends. So I did this television interview with Ron, and you know, people were expecting to hear sex questions, which is the funny thing that I do. People like think of porn, wink, wink, nudge, nudge. I don't talk to these porn stars about sex. We talk about, I want to show them as real life human beings.
Yeah.
Show the human side of them. And that's what I want to do with Ron. I mean,
they expect the same questions from every reporter.
Yeah.
And when you throw them something completely different, he lit up and was fully engaged.
He was very, very happy because he saw me coming. He's like, oh no, what's he going to ask me? And it was a very intellectual interview. And then I went back in and being Alexander.
Yeah, that was the funny part. He was definitely into his Alexander mode by the time
it was day three.
Yeah, and so the slur, the walking, and then he goes, "I'm going to do interview." Okay. And who was it with the camera?
Mike Preston. Yeah, who has a TV show also.
So he said, "Yeah, I'll let you do an interview." So he gets on camera, and as soon as Alex sits, he's like, all of a sudden he's like this, and hey, perfect interview voice and great conversation. And once he was done, thank you very much.
Stage health kicked in.
Back to being Alex.
I would think though, for somebody like Ron Jeremy, just think of all—he probably gets the same questions every single one of those, and like and at some point, you know.
And you opened with Tammy Faye, and then you went from there.
Yeah, and it's something he really wanted to talk about. But like anybody, like I said, you know, when I interview these girls, ladies, we don't talk about sex. We talk about life, you know, like with Brie Olson. And she was telling me like her dream was to open a restaurant in Lafayette, Indiana. And, you know, she wanted to be a chef. Never happened because then came Charlie Sheen.
Oh, right.
3 degrees of Charlie Sheen and me, okay? Well, Ginger Lynn first, met her, his ex-girlfriend. Then I hung out for a weekend in Vegas with Heidi Fleiss and then Brie Olson. And they all three kissed me, too.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, so I got strep throat or bronchitis after Brie, though.
I thought you were going to get something. No.
Yeah, I see where he was going with
it. I don't know, a bunch of tampons and a cell phone. Oh God, these inside jokes are killing me. Max, any good stories from your trips?
Nothing. Just
where'd you go?
Minnesota this last time for family Thanksgiving, and we took over the duties of running it from our parents, and it was long overdue. It went smooth. I mean, for the 10 of us to get 80 people together.
Wow!
Holy shit!
Yeah, because my dad has 12. You know, he's of a tribe of 12. So they have a bunch of cousins and the cousins' kids.
Oh,
so
wow.
It's grown to
interesting
a massive family up there.
Yeah, I just see. It looks like you have fun with your sisters and all that. And I like the Texas. You know, Max and I, you lived in Dallas, grew up there, right?
Yeah, I grew up there.
But I lived there for the summer of '83, and we were talking about this just out of the blue. This club called Tangos, which was like the punk rock dance club in Dallas. It was an old bank.
And it was a mix. It was the punk rock area, and upstairs was the video room because the videos were brand new, and they had this bank of TVs, and they had a video room, video bar, the main stage bar, and then the side, like you said, the punk room. It was a different, they had set it up for different areas.
Oh, right on.
And so, but the funny thing is, I got a thing for frogs, even the gay frogs.
I got it.
We were talking about Tangos, and they had this frog on the roof.
three of them. No, it was the musicians. There was a saxophonist. There was a playing a guitar, and one was singing.
And you went back like last summer, and you sent me a picture because
my sister, she took me to this place called the Truck Yard, and what it is what it sounds like. It's bar and a truck yard full of a bunch of food trucks that change out weekly, which is an awesome concept. And as we round the corner of the truck yard, I see these frogs on the ground fenced in. I'm like, holy shit, I have to send these to Alex right away.
I got a kick out of it, too. You know, I went down to...
These are trick frogs.
I went down the tongue of a frog in a swimming pool once. And that's just where we're going
next. When I was six.
And then you broke up with her.
No, this was in 19... this was in 2017. November of 2017, that was the last LA gun show I saw that year, and I picked this hotel out because they had a kid's pool that had a giant frog who slid down it, and it was really busy. There was a lot of kids in there the first day, so I told my friend Jason, like, wake me up at 6, we're going in there, and I'm going to get in that fucking frog and slide down it. And I'll have to post a picture back up on Facebook. I'm coming down, I'm like, and the water splashes up, and I just had so much fun. And we're going there because it was next door to Quaker Steak and Lube, and we're doing my annual birthday trip there.
Yeah, I've seen you talking about that.
And, you know, we make the pilgrimage there. A lot of friends come from all over, and Max and I take the train down. This year, Detroit Jason's going to go with us, and we make the afternoon of it. We're not just going to go there and eat. We're going to make an afternoon. We're hanging. I'm seeing friends I don't usually get to see, and there's going to be a lot of that this year. But I'm looking forward to that with you and Jason, and I think that train ride back is going to be interesting. They might have to put us in a different car.
I think they wanted to put us in a different restaurant after our first 30 minutes of conversation.
Well, Eden was with us, and then she gives me this. She's a photographer, artist, you know, a woman of many, many talents. But she made me this giant print that she took of a woman's butt, and she gives this tube. She goes, "Open it up." And there's families there and looking at this woman's ass. Jesus Christ! Speak of the devil.
Next week, Sunday, December 11, 2022, from Chicago, Illinois, the home of Ministry, Wax Tracks, and Invisible Records, on the MK Ultrasound Podcast, Alex Zander and Detroit Jason Kensky, the Polish Hammer, going to bring you their favorite hard rock bands from the Motor City to you, the listener. As always, special guests and some Kiss trivia. Join us then.
Hey, that was the same one we played last time.
It absolutely was.
Holy shit. I think I did the same one twice. Oh, fuck. Anyway.
The other one was the Cream Magazine one.
Yeah, and then, but I thought I think I renamed it wrong.
Then do it you live. Can hear so, Chicago.
Do it live. Do it live. I'll tell you what. Let's go to your next song, and I'll get the right one up.
Kiss
trivia. So this next song, you sent me the video.
Yeah, this is hot off the press. Just got it back Friday. Empire Animate out of Vancouver made it, but... This is called The Year Hope Failed, and the samples in this are actually a recording from a meeting I had in 2015 with a future scientist at Microsoft who was talking about how all these fresh out of college jobs are going to get replaced by AI. So when he talks about the humans being shit at data and the world as a data, that's actually a real meeting that we had in Seattle. And
wow, that's interesting.
So it's not like this is actually real life imitating art or art imitating life.
But, and for those of you watching this, because it's going to be, you know, audio first, you get to see it when Cassie puts this show together. I'd like to have your feedback so that we can share it with Dave about what you think of the visuals of not just this video, but all of them.
Oh, yeah, man.
Right. I mean, you're one of those artists that you just like Ayatoya. She has a video for everything.
It's fun, you know, I never used to be like that, and then I start, and it's like crack, I'm just going to do this all the time now.
Okay, and we're going to hear this right now on the MK Ultrasound Podcast.
The data problem, you all know about this, right?
yelling at me at the time.
I hand it to you, man. First of all, you always bring new product to the show, and you're a great guest.
Oh, thanks.
But you consistently deliver music. It's like...
Oh, well, yeah, thanks.
Well, since I've known you.
I try. Well, I think, you know, working with Sean now, he's very much... He likes to kind of give things time, you know, like, okay, just let this sit and then come back. And you always find things that, like, you know, like you want to tweak or do better. And this is probably the first time I've released something that I could still listen to a couple months after we finished it and, like, just listen to it.
Do you always have it?
You always find, like, a couple things, like, you wish you would have fixed it or something. And so he's been – so I think we'll probably slow down a bit with this because I think that's so important, you know.
But, a lot of the people in our – Orbit cranked out so much music during COVID. I think that was the one thing about being, you know, locked in at home. Pretty much the people I know were consistently like making product and then putting videos out, you know, live videos. And I liked when musicians would be in different places and they would play on the same song and go back and forth. And that was super cool. I think that's the only good thing that came out of COVID other than I just started hating on Lori Lightfoot even more.
God. Yeah, I noticed that. where I live in Elmhurst, we weren't playing. Like we stopped playing COVID after about 6 months.
So, anybody got a movie they're looking forward to see next year?
Not I.
Well,
the part three of
Pearl. Maxine, but Maxine. Oh. You got one, Dave?
Oh, well, I just, before I left to come here, I watched that trailer for the new Indiana Jones, and is the kid in me is holding out hope they might pull it off, but we'll see.
I'm looking
for... But I want to see it just for the sake
I want to see Megan.
Which one's
about that?
That
android girl?
Oh, I haven't even heard that.
The trailer? You haven't seen it?
Nope.
Oh, my God. It's fucking phenomenal. It's this mother, somebody makes something for her daughter whose sister died or something, and they create, it's kind of like the movie AI, a kid to have a companion, but this doll will, person, doll, whatever, will kill you if you fuck with their friend.
And there was a Twilight episode, a Twilight Zone episode about that.
I mean, this thing looks creepy as fuck.
Perfect.
And I've already got a date, and it's Friday the 13th of January.
Well, yeah.
As I'm taking
the marketing rights itself.
Melanie, who I met at the Looney Bin through Nick Hoffman, and sad to say this, this is going to be the first birthday December that I haven't been at the Looney Bin in 8 years. And I miss Nick, and I made so many friends there. Emily, you know, my everybody's favorite co-host on this show.
Sure,
And she's dynamite. She's dynamite as a friend. She's dynamite as a talented person. But she's just a dynamite all around person and fun, and you know, not too bad on the eyes. But it's gonna be sad not going down there because I met her on my birthday when I was still on the cane. Remember that when I couldn't? I was crippled. And before my hip replacement, and I was down there on the cane the first night, and that's how I met Emily, and it been friends ever since. You wanted the best, and you got the best. The hottest band in the world, Kiss. Believe it or not, the worst I've ever done on this was with the Joy Thief show. I'm telling you, I nailed these questions, but they were just fucking with me, and it was, that was a lot of fun.
I didn't know you could fuck with you on these. Oh, well, that changes everything.
All right, and then I can't wait for next week to do this with Detroit Jason, and just, I'm really looking forward to the next weekend altogether. So,
The Elder was based on Iron Eagle. I'm
what? Go ahead, you're up first.
I was thinking of things to fuck with you on.
You've got
on
the buzzer.
Trivia.
You got the buzzer and the bell right in front of you. So I get it right, the bell, I get it wrong, the buzzer, please. All right. That Elder was based on Iron Eagle. Okay, go ahead.
Now, I wish I had more time with these because I would like. All right. I don't know the answer to any of these, so I'm curious what they are. Who wrote the short story The Elder was based on?
Oh,
oh well, now
I have to say Gene Simmons.
Yes.
Chaim Witz, his real name.
No, I'm sorry. That was Ace Frehley.
Fucking Ace. That's when he left the band. And I felt bad for Eric Carr because that was his first record. And it was he's the most powerful drummer. Would have take Kiss to a heavier level sooner. But yeah, if I was Ace, I would have left. All right, Max.
What Kiss song are the following lyrics from? I thought about the back door. I didn't know what to say.
Oh, nothing to lose. And it's about, you know what it's about, the song?
Do not.
I knew the song
I know what it's
like
about.
20 years. And one day I'm listening to it, I'm like, is that song about anal sex? And I Googled it on Wikipedia. There it is. Gene Simmons wrote that song in 1973 about butt fucking. Okay. Dave.
Who is supposed to play the keyboard parts on Radioactive, but unfortunately arrived too late?
Oh, that was on Gene's solo album, the first song that had a lot of people playing on it. A keyboard player, it would have been a hot keyboard player at the time. Arrived too late, so 1978. Who's a keyboard player? I don't know. I'm just going to say, as a guest, Greg Jafria?
No, it's Huey Lewis.
Shut the fuck up. Who was it? Was it Greg Jafria?
Is Jerry Lee Lewis?
Buzz.
Buzzer.
Wow, that would have been awesome. Jerry Lee Lewis is late for everything, including his own funeral.
Who played?
I was hoping you'd get it right, so I could say no. It was Huey Lewis.
Who played lead guitar on "Sweet Pain" on "Destroyer"?
Rick Derringer. Fuck, I got that wrong. Who was it?
Dick Wagner.
From Alice Cooper Band.
Dick Wagner.
Wow. Dick Wagger.
Dick Wagler.
Okay.
What was the first thing Kiss did upon their arrival in Japan in 1977? That's actually pretty
good. Got massages?
No. They had to remove their makeup for the Japanese customs officers.
That's right. Buzz me out. Fuck. I'm Joy Thieves bad today.
Okay, name the three Italian members of KISS.
The three what?
The three Italian members of KISS.
Prediker Scola, Vinnie Vincent, who is Vincent Cassano, and Tommy Thayer?
You get two rings and one buzz. Eric Carr.
Oh, that's right. Oh, yeah. God, Carvolo. Damn, fuck. And that guy was awesome.
You got to call yourself Eric Carr.
He wanted his dumb name like, Dick Rockets or something like that. That's
Dick
not
Rockets. Like, No. I want to be called Dick Rockets.
Hey, yeah. Dave, thanks for coming in.
Yeah, man.
It's always a blast with you. Always bring great music to the show. Max, thank you for stepping in and being wonderful.
Anytime.
I know that we're going to go out for something after this. But I want to thank you, the listener, your loyal listeners. Thank Cassie for doing a bang-up job on this show as always. Scott, it's always good talking to cars with you. I want to say hi to the friends I'm going to see next weekend, and then Bob Hoaxham on New Year's Eve, and I Love Rich on December 23rd. You've been listening to the MKUltrasound Podcast. I'm Alexander. Please like and share.